Glory to you, O Lord. For God so loved the world that God sent his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do not do what is right, but those who do what is true, come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from our living God and from our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. So let me again provide the context for Luther's sermon today. After writing his early writings, Luther, of course, was called to defend himself at what was known as the Diet at Worms. And after doing so, it became apparent that he was indeed going to be taken as a heretic. And so he was quickly escorted for his own safety to Wartburg Castle, where he remained in seclusion and hiding for a few years. Now, while Luther was in Wartburg Castle, back in Wittenberg, the reformers who were following Luther began to implement a lot of the changes and reforms that Luther desired, particularly in terms of the worship service. But they did so, let us just say, over exuberantly. They did so with gusto. They implemented these forms so quickly and so completely that the congregation and the town became quite upset and disturbed at everything that was happening, and there were literally riots in the streets. And so Luther gets word of what's happening, and he sneaks back to Wittenberg. And while he is there, he preaches a series of 8 sermons. The one that I'm going to be using excerpts from today is his 2nd sermon at Wittenberg. And essentially what Luther is saying to the congregation is he agrees with what they are doing, but the way in which they are going about it is causing too much chaos. Therefore, you just need to slow down a little bit. What we're going to hear in this particular sermon, and it was also brought up in last week's sermon, it was something that was a particular thorn in Luther's side, and that was known as the private mass. And the private mass was when an individual priest or monk would say mass just for themselves. No one else was invited, but this would happen daily, multiple times in the church. Priests would come and they would say mass for themselves, and they considered it to be a good work. Well, Luther, of course, was having none of this. He wanted the private mass abolished, instead calling for all services to be known as what he called the evangelical mass, which simply meant that everyone was invited. And so we're going to hear Luther speaking about the private mass today. The second thing that I want you to listen for is how highly Luther holds up the word. Over and over again in the sermon, we're going to hear about how it is the word that accomplishes that which God desires. Not us of our own desires. higher faith in God's people. And so here is part of Luther's second sermon at Wittenberg. Dear friends, you heard yesterday the characteristics of a Christian, how his whole life is faith and love. Faith is directed toward God, love toward man and one's neighbor, and it consists in such love and service for him as we receive from God without our work and merit. Thus, there are two things. The one which is the most needful and which must be done in one way and no other. The other thing, which is a matter of choice and not of necessity, which may be kept or not without endangering one's faith or incurring the wrath of hell. In both, however, love must deal with our neighbor in the same manner as God has dealt with us. It must walk the straight road, straying neither to the left nor to the right. In the things which are musts and are matters of necessity, such as believing in Christ, love nevertheless never uses force or undue constraint. The private mass is an evil thing, and God is displeased with it, because it is performed as a sacrifice and a work of merit. Therefore, it must be abolished. Here there is no room for question, just as little as if you should ask whether or not to pray to God. Here we are entirely agreed. The private mass must be abolished, as I have said in my writings. And I heartily wish it would be abolished everywhere, and only the evangelical mass for all the people be retained. Yet Christian love should not employ harshness here, nor force the matter. It should be preached and taught with tongue and pen that to hold a mass in such a manner is a sin. But no one should be dragged away from it by force. The matter should be left to God. His word should do the work alone, without our work. Why? Because it is not in my power to fashion the hearts of men as a potter molds the clay. I can get no further than to men's ears. Their hearts I cannot reach. And since I cannot pour faith into their hearts, I cannot, nor should I, force anyone to have faith. That is God's work alone, who causes faith to live in the heart. We should preach the word, but the consequences must be left to God's own pleasure. Love, therefore, demands that you have compassion on the weak, as all the apostles had. Once, when Paul came to Athens, a mighty city, he found in the temple many idolatrous altars. And he went from one to the other and he looked at them all, but he did not touch any one of them, not even with his feet. But he stood in the midst of the marketplace and said they were all adulterous works, and he begged the people to forsake them. Yet he did not destroy any of them by force. When of their own accord, and in consequence, idolatry fell of itself. Now, if I had seen that they held mass, I would have preached and admonished them concerning it. Had they heeded my admonition, then they would have been won. If not, I would nevertheless not have torn them from their private mass by their hair, or employed any force, but simply I would have allowed the word to act while I prayed for them. For it is the word that created heaven and earth and all things. The word must do this thing, and not we poor sinners. In conclusion, I will preach. But I will constrain no man by force, for faith must come freely without compulsion. Take myself as an example. I have opposed the indulgences and all the papists, but never by force. I simply taught, preached, and wrote God's word. Otherwise, I did nothing. And then while I slept or drank Wittenberg beer with my friends Philip and Amsdorf, the word so greatly weakened the papacy that never a prince or emperor inflicted such damage upon it. I did nothing. The word did it all. Let us pray. Most gracious God, so many times in our lives we seek to rely upon ourselves and upon our own actions, things that we do to try to bring others to faith or to change another's minds. But Lord, we are told, and Luther reminds us today, to simply remain in your word, to share your word, to study your word, and to allow your word to work in our lives and in the lives of our sisters and brothers. Use us this day, O God, and in all the days ahead, to be megaphones of your word, that your will might be done in your good time and in your good measure. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.